Welcome to this webinar today. This is an initiative of our Institute of Child Health, Kolkata. Here I must say a few words about our institute. Institute of Child Health, Kolkata happens to be the first teaching children hospital in India. I repeat it, it is the first teaching children hospital in India. It was established way back in 1957. And exactly we are 63 years old now. And I am very happy and proud to be a part of this institute where we have a wonderful pediatric dermatology unit. Me and my able colleagues, Dr. Raghubir Banerjee, Dr. Rajiv Malakar, we are the old folks over here. For more than 2 decades, we have some helping hands in the form of junior colleagues Dr. Abhijit Shah and Nishant Agarwal, and all this freedom of working, preaching and practicing pediatric dermatology has been given by our director Professor Apurva Ghosh. I express my sincere gratitude to him for this opportunity. Today, I understand, apart from the pediatricians, much beyond the ambit of our institute, I am sure there are many pediatricians from other parts of the state, other parts of the country also. And I understand there are many dermatologist colleagues of mine from different parts of India in today's webinar. So, accordingly, I have formatted my presentation in such a way that it caters to everybody, to dermatologists as well as to the pediatricians. So certain percentage of cases will be for pediatricians. It will be too easy for the dermatologists, whereas certain percentage of cases will be a bit tough, which will be mainly targeted for the dermatologist. And I would like to make it an interactive session during the entire 1 hour or so. And I'll request all of you to listen to me carefully that what you have to do. I'm sure that by this time, many of you, in fact, all of you have done many webinars and you know the basic P's and Q's of webinars. Still, I repeat it just for the sake of routine, guidance, that you will see at the lowest level, there is a bar. And you see there is a chat box. I can see already there is some questions in the chat box. Apart from that, in the question answer box also, you can send or post your questions. During my presentations pertaining to the case, I shall appreciate if you ask your questions pertaining to the case rather than in general, pediatric dermatology, which is by far an ocean. And it won't be possible for me to cover every aspect of it within just 60 minutes or so. So that's why it will be a series of webinar from Pediatric Dermatology Department. You will get to know about it in more detail subsequently. At the outset, I would like to sincerely thank Dr. Reddy's lab, Mr. Devabrata and his team for supporting this academic endeavor of ours. With this, I go straight to the cases. So during each case, I'll ask you some questions which you can post in the chat box or in the question answer session. Either answer or you can ask pertinent questions. I'll give you 10 seconds for that. And then we'll move on further with the discussion. Now let us start. This is a 3-year-old boy who presented with high fever and features of toxemia and was admitted in our institute. Look at the rash. This is a maculopapular rash along with high fever, failure to thrive, features of toxemia. Do you see something very characteristic? question is, what is this rash? Yes, I can see Dr. Sudeep Ghosh, you know, my colleague in dermatology. He is an academic giant, and Resham Vasani from Mumbai. Both of them are very close to me. So very rightly pointed out, this is island of sparing of normal skin. But here I must say that we used to believe earlier that it exclusively occurs in dengue fever. Of late, I have seen in a couple of other conditions also, like septicemia also. But by and large, it is present in approximately 40% of the cases of dengue fever. So many of you have answered. So diagnosis and skin finding, you have already mentioned the diagnosis as well as skin finding. This is the classical dengue rash of hemorrhagic rash, as it is called dengue hemorrhagic fever. It used to be called, conventionally called, dengue hemorrhagic fever. And this is exactly what you see as the hemorrhage because of thrombocytopenia. That is the main red flag sign in dengue. Subconjunctival hemorrhage you see in dengue fever. And this is the classical island of normal looking skin in the red ocean, as it is described as. So this is dengue fever. Thank you very much. So, and also you have come to know that this is present in approximately 40% of the cases. What is the other significance of it? Anyone would like to answer? The moment you see this rash, what significance you get? Any other significance you can say? When does it appear? My good friend Dr. Rajiv Sharma from Aligarh, who was there with me in PGI Chandigarh. I can see Dr. Raghubir Banerjee. Yes, it is during the recovery phase. So you see it, very rightly said, Raghubir. You see when there is recovery after approximately 2 to 3 weeks. So from this, the significance of it, prognostic significance of it, is that whenever you see such rash, you can tell the parents that, look, so much platelet depletion occurs, thrombocytopenia occurs, but within a day or two, gradually thrombocyte or platelet recovery will occur. And there is tremendous amount of correlation between this type of rash with the platelet recovery. In fact, the first article which came 15 years ago in NEJM about the dengue, comprehensive article, there also this skin rash which was projected or showcased was this type of rash. So this is the prognostic significance of this rash. So come to the next case. 3-year-old girl with skin lesions for 6 months. For my pediatrician friends, anything you would like to ask? Anything you would like to see in such a case? Yes, who is of course over palms. You know, I can see Dr. Sanjeev Agarwal has directly answered it. Well, this is very important, and this sign is known as Dhar sign, right? This is Dhar sign, abdominal cramps. Yes, Dr. Rajiv, abdominal cramp, wheezing, all this suggests that there is mast cell induced, mast cell liberate histamine, and that induced systemic effects is occurring with in the form of systemic effect. Diarrhea is also systemic effect. So this is mastocytosis, collections of mast cells in the skin, in different parts of the skin as well as in the system. So we know that the solitary mastocytosis, there is diffuse cutaneous mastocytosis. Mastocytosis can be associated with various systemic involvement and infiltration of the mast cells in the liver and lung and many other organs of the body. So this is the case of mastocytosis, and this is the classical Dhar sign. You stroke the mastocytic lesions and you see there is articulation not only on the lesion, in the surrounding area also. And that is the characteristic feature of Dhar sign, as you can see over here. So this was Dhar sign in mastocytosis. So once again, I'll request my pediatrician colleagues and friends to ask me questions today while discussing the cases pertaining to the case. And any unrelated question on general pediatric dermatology, if the time permits, maybe at the end for 15-20 minutes, I'll be more than happy to answer. But while discussing the cases, please restrict your questions to the cases only. So while I'm showing you mastocytosis, ask me anything which you would like to know regarding mastocytosis, right? So investigation for mastocytosis, you have to do routine hematology. You have to do the liver function test. You have to do the urine RE. And systemic involvement, yes, for systemic involvement you have to, but from the confirmation of the diagnosis you have to do a skin biopsy. And for ruling out systemic involvement, you have to see the serum tryptase level, which should be very high. And here I would like to know one thing from you, that mastocytosis, when there is extensive systemic involvement, would you like to do a genetic analysis? If yes, what gene is responsible for that? Anyone would like to answer that question? What gene is responsible? Yes, c-kit gene. Yes, Dr. Resham, very right. I can see Dr. Sandipan Mukherjee also. Yes, if the number at more than less than 10 lesions in a 3-month ordering borderline elevation of serum tryptase level and no systemic symptoms, should we initiate treatment or wait and observe the child? If the number of lesions are less than 10 in a 3-month old child with borderline elevation of serum tryptase, I think we should not wait in any case of mastocytosis, when serum, particularly when you diagnose it. And when you see the serum tryptase level is high, well, it means you start the antihistamines. Whether you should give oral steroids, corticosteroids or not, that will depend on the further course of the child. Okay, Dr. Samipa. So, sorry, c-kit mutation was the right answer for the genetic analysis. Now, any other questions related to mastocytosis? No. So, if no, then let me go to the next case. So this was a case of Dhar sign in mastocytosis. Yes, initiated on antihistamines. Yes, Samipa, that is very right. You have to, one has to start on antihistamine, right? Dr. Provas has also very rightly pointed out c-kit gene. Yes, very right. So let us go to the next case. This is a 8-year-old boy with this pigmentation over the face. Look at the pigmentation very carefully. And there is pigmentation over the lower lip and upper lip also. I'll show you more pictures. You see pigmentation over the fingertips. There is some, you know, some specific significance why this picture has been taken like that. This child was seen by us at Institute of Child Health. Look at the pigmentation carefully over the lip. And what do you think? What is the diagnosis? Sudeep is, Dr. Sudeep Ghosh is unstoppable. Let the others also speak, Sudeep. No, I'm just joking. You feel free to answer. I'm very happy to see that we have got, you know, a galaxy of pediatricians, and many of my dermatologist colleagues have also joined, and all of them are expert in their field. They know a lot of pediatric dermatology, and that is making me a bit nervous also. Okay. So here you would like to take any more history? Any history? It is not incontinentia pigmentae. Incontinentia pigmentae, you see mostly over the trunk. It is, you know, distributed in a Chinese part-free pattern. History of GI bleed, Dr. Prabhas very rightly said. I know, yes, family history, Dr. Dhiraj. GI polyposis, Dr. Archana Singhal. Oh my God. I can see all top notches of our dermatology. And making me very shaky, in fact. So this is a case of yes, look at the pigmentation further. This type of picture you won't even see in any standard textbooks of pediatric dermatology also. Such classical pigmentation. Yes, this is a case of Peutz-Jeghers syndrome, and the commonest association is GI polyposis. And GI polyposis, polyps can occur from gastroesophageal junction till the anal canal. Usually, stomach is not affected, though there are few case reports of polyposis in the stomach also. But by and large, it is the small intestine in general, and jejunum in particular, which gets maximum affected by intestinal polyposis. And GI bleed, pain abdomen is often the feature. So this is a case of Peutz-Jeghers syndrome. Okay, we'll move on to the next case. So it was a case of Peutz-Jeghers syndrome. Come to the next case. This is a 5-year-old boy with history of high fever and toxemia for 7 days and skin lesions for 5 days. So let us look at the picture. 5-year-old boy, history of fever, very high grade fever for 7 days, toxemia for 7 days, and this skin lesion for 5 days. The child was admitted in our ICH ward, as you can see here. So what are you thinking in the line of? So I can see some of my colleagues, they're so knowledgeable. Before I ask the questions, they are throwing the answer. Like I can see Dr. Sudeep Ghosh, Resham Basani. Yes. See more pictures, then we'll come to the diagnosis. This is close up. Yes, you are right. This is a case of purpura fulminans. I shall come in, about it subsequently more detail. This is the extensive necrosis, and somebody has written meningococcal infection. Yes, in fact, this child had meningococcemia. That is one of the commonest cause of infectious cause of purpura fulminans. And in children, infection is the commonest cause of purpura fulminans. And this large area of necrosis is very common, very characteristic feature of purpura fulminans, and it occurs because of deficiency of protein C or protein S. What are protein C and protein S? These are two, vitamin K dependent glycoproteins, which act as antithrombotic agent. The moment they are deficient, so thrombosis occurs, intracapillary coagulation occurs. As a result, there is necrosis occurs, and the border is always, zigzag like this. I can see some questions in the chat. So purpura fulminans, yes, purpura fulminans, yes. Associated, Dr. Kumud Agarwal has said very rightly, associated condition to rule out disseminated intravascular coagulation, DIC. That's why investigation in this child, apart from routine investigation, should include fibrin degradation product, FDP, apart from total coagulation profile, FDP, D-dimers, and all these things to rule out DIC. And treatment, apart from the treatment of the basic conditions, say for example, antibiotics, IV antibiotics cocktail for meningococcal infection, you have to give fresh frozen plasma. If you are lucky and if you can arrange protein C or protein S from abroad because it is not available in our setup, then it is better. But fresh frozen plasma is more or less fair enough if most of the children, whatever we have treated, in our ward, a lot of children with purpura fulminans we have treated in Institute of Child Health. How to differentiate protein C and meningococcemia? It is not a classical rash of meningococcemia. Meningococcemia can produce an array of skin rashes, starting from vasculitic lesions over the legs, starting from henoxolan purpura-like lesions, starting from small tick bite-like lesions to purpura fulminans. So purpura fulminans is one of the cause of, meningococcemia is one of the cause of purpura fulminans. So there is no question of differentiating it protein C deficiency. It is a secondary deficiency due to infection, protein C deficiency. Primary deficiency may be present from birth, that is genetically mediated. So you see the response in this child. This was the result after 10 days of treatment of meningococcal infections as well as stress frozen plasma. And this is the close-up. So this was the case of purpura fulminans. So we'll go to the next case. This is a healthy newborn of 15 days, skin lesions present since birth. However, on the lesions, if you press, baby cries out. Wincing of the baby on pressing the lesions. I request my dermatologist colleague to first keep quiet, give chance to pediatrician colleagues. But this is the condition which I am sure the pediatricians see maximum, much more common than dermatologists in the NICU setup. Yes, I can see Dr. Moushumi Mukherjee has very rightly pointed out, Dr. Datta, A. Datta, also subcutaneous fat necrosis, Dr. Jayadeep Das, this is subcutaneous fat necrosis. Yes, very right. Now, I'll ask these questions to all of you. So, why this subcutaneous fat necrosis occurs? because of fetal asphyxia, I know, we know, because of labored breathing, problem in the labor or fetal asphyxia, a difficult labor, all these situations you know. But why this necrosis occurs? What is the reason? Okay, I shall come to that later on. So if you see such a baby, apart from the routine investigations, what else you will do? What particular investigation you will do? Yes, let me see in the chat. Serum calcium. Dr. Bhavani Singh from Bhubaneswar. Yes, sudden death. Dr. Jaydeep Das says sudden death due to hypercalcemia. Very right. Absolutely right. Yes, serum calcium level. Dr. Sujata says very rightly pointed out. But let me ask you one question. Why serum calcium level is high? Why it becomes high in subcutaneous fat necrosis? What is the explanation? This question is open to all, both my dermatologist and pediatrician colleagues. Why serum calcium becomes high in subcutaneous fat necrosis? A partial answer I am getting, 125 vitamin D. What does it mean? Can you elaborate? Yes, Samipa has partly answered, increased prostaglandin activity. Okay, fine. But what it has got to do with, calcium level? Yes, prostaglandin increased activity is one. Osteoclastic, no, I'm sorry. Anyone else? Interleukin release from granuloma increases alpha hydroxylation vitamin D2 and D3. Not exactly. Something more than that. Increased intestinal uptake of calcium happens. Yes. Yes, Dr. Sabipa. Why? Why does it happen? Why does it happen? Because of two reasons. Let me tell you now. Let us not give further time, because lot many more interesting cases are there. There are two ways of increased calcium level in subcutaneous fat necrosis. One is direct liberation of calcium from the necrosed fat. That is number one. And number two is there is increased production from the necrosed fat 125 dihydroxycholecalciferol D3. That leads to increased intestinal absorption of calcium. This is how there is hypercalcemia, which occurs in subcutaneous fat necrosis. And should you really bother about it? Usually not. You just wait and watch. Give enough fluid to the child. Most of the cases, it is self-limiting. Otherwise, you have to intervene with bisphosphonate, oral steroids, diuresis, and so many other things. Let us go to the next case. So this was a case of, I told you, this case you see in our Institute of Child Health, you look at the serum calcium level, it was very high. So this was a case of subcutaneous fat necrosis of the newborn. Let us go to the next case. This is a 4-year-old girl with skin lesions since birth, some lesions for last 6 months. Lesions since birth are asymptomatic, and lesions of recent dates were mildly itchy. Look it carefully. And I'll request my dermatologist colleague not to jump. Yes, I'll show you another picture. What do you see? What is the diagnosis? Now everybody can take part in answering, both dermatologists and pediatrician colleagues and friends. Articaria pigmentosa, Dr. Bernal is asked, correct? Articaria pigmentosa is something which is marked with arrow. And what are the other things? What are the other pigmentation? There are two types of pigmentation here. One pigmentation is articaria pigmentosa. And what is the other pigmentation? I can see Dr. Yes, Dr. Sanipa, Mongolian spots. Absolutely right. So in Mongolian spot, you see dermal melanocytes. And in articaria pigmentosa, the cause of pigmentation, we exactly do not know. Why does it happen? The pigmentation, does it happen? Right? So there are both, actually, this is a tricky case. So these are all Mongolian spots. These are Mongolian spots. And in between Mongolian spots, there are hyperpigmented macules, which when stroked, they articulated, and we picked them up because this looked to us that this is a mixture of articaria pigmentosa and Mongolian spots. So this was a bit tricky case for us in the OPD of ICH. This is a hazy picture, I'm sorry. Mongolian spot with articaria pigmentosa. Okay, we'll go to the next case. This is a 12-year-old boy with hyperpigmentation of 1 year, extreme weakness, and low blood pressure. Look at the boy. I'll show you more pictures. Don't jump to the diagnosis. See more pictures. And I'll ask you questions related to some of the other features. Look at the eyes carefully. I'm giving you enough hints. This is close up of the pigmentation over the tongue, over the knuckle, over interdigital part of the skin on the dorsum. Sorry. Yes, I'm sure that you can make the diagnosis. What is the diagnosis? Addison's disease. Very straightforward, isn't it? Very simple. Addisonian pigmentation. Okay. So there is more story to it. The story does not end over here. So that's why I gave you earlier so many hints, because I know that 100% of you will be able to make a diagnosis of Addison's disease in this, irrespective of pediatrician or dermatologist. So now the real challenge comes. The child also gave a history of dysphagia. This is barium swallow esophagus, showing achalasia. This I will request my colleagues in Institute of Child Health not to jump to the answer. Many of you know it. And because this we discussed in our seminar, the child also had dry eyes. That's why I asked you to look at the eyes. So with this, anything you would like to offer? Any diagnosis? Suman, I told you not to answer. Dr. Suman Poddar. So you will be barred from taking part in it. Dr. Suman Poddar is a brilliant microbiologist. I know, I look into the microbiology part, actually. He is doing our dermatophyte PCR, the study which we are carrying out at Institute of Child Health. He is the principal investigator for that. Dr. Rajesh Sampurkai, so you are ex-ICH, so you know what it is. Alacrimation, Addison's, Achalasia. Dr. Bhavani Singh from Bhubaneswar. Yes, you are right. Dr. Subhankar, Algrove, absolutely right you are. So this is actually a condition which is rare, but credit goes to all of you who answered very rightly. This is also known as 3A syndrome. Achalasia, as we have seen, alacrimation, dry eyes, and additionally pigmentation. This is also known as Algrove syndrome. Here I must say that in Addisonian pigmentation, you may see the pigmentation of the gum. Otherwise, also in many other conditions, you see pigmentation of the leaves, pigmentation of the gum, and don't jump to the diagnosis of Addison's in a normal looking child just looking at the pigmentation of the gum. The reason is pigmentation of the gum, whenever you see, you call other siblings, you call the parents, look at the gum and tongue. In type 4, type 5 skin, in Indian skin, this is a physiological pigmentation. Don't diagnose suddenly this is like a clearness of the tongue, or pigmentation of the tongue means Addisonian pigmentation, or this is arsenicosis. Don't diagnose like that. This is called familial oral mucosal pigmentation, which Dr. Kanwar and I diagnosed, described it way back in 1995 in IJDVL. Dr. Kanwar is my teacher who brought me to pediatric dermatology as well as atopic dermatitis. Coming to the next case, this is a 3-year-old girl, history of mild fever for 10 days, skin rash for 7 days. Look at it carefully. Don't jump to the diagnosis. Look at it carefully. Look at the lesions carefully. So now the question comes, what is the diagnosis? I request dermatologist colleague to, for the timing, to hold on. Let our pediatrician colleagues first answer. Of course, after that, you will be given chance. No, it is not herpes zoster. It looks like pleva. Somebody, if he has said that it is a pleva, I still think that yes, he knows certain things about pleva also. Good. But it is not pleva. It looks like pleva, but this is not pleva. This is called in Hindi, lagta hai par hai nahi. This used to happen in our PGI days. I think Rajiv remembers. Whenever a junior used to take a case to his senior resident, yes sir, ye to, what do you think? Kya lag raha hai? Bole sir, dekh ke to ye sarcoidosis lagta hai. Bole yaar, sarcoidosis to lagta hai, par wo hai nahi. So this used to be the answer. So this is also pleva looking, but not pleva. So now my dermatologist colleagues can try. As asymptomatic periflexural exanthem of children. I'm sorry, this is not the right answer. Asymptomatic periflexural exanthem is also known as unilateral laterothoracic exanthem. This is not unilateral. This is number one. And number two, that is a maculopapular rash. Here you see collapsed vesicles. See it carefully. These are all collapsed vesicles on an eczematous background. I think I have given you enough hints now. I won't give you any more hint. Atopic eczema. Atopic eczema is there, but this is not Kaposi's variceliform eruption, Bhavani. No, Sudeep, this is not Kaposi's variceliform eruption. This is not eczema herpeticum, Sumipa. Yes, yes, somebody has rightly pointed out the answer. I cannot read the name. This is basically hand, foot and mouth disease lesions on a background of eczema, and this is called eczema coxsackium. This is called eczema coxsackium. This is a relatively new entity, eczema coxsackium. So this is just like eczema herpeticum, eczema coxsackium. So that brings me to just to share with my pediatrician colleagues that how does hand, foot and mouth disease look like. I'm sure that you see the maximum cases of this in your day-to-day practice. It classically presents with vesicles like this, looks like chickenpox. Many a times it is confused with chickenpox. But please do remember two important features by which you will be able to differentiate. A chickenpox, a child having chickenpox will never get into your chamber walking and having absolutely normal looking health. It's not sick at all, not febrile at all, if at all, very mildly febrile. This is number one. And the child doesn't look sick. And second thing, once you look at the lesions are all monomorphic. They are not polymorphic like chickenpox. Inside the mouth. Yes, in chickenpox also see lesions inside the mouth, but lesions over the skin are polymorphous lesions. Here, all lesions are monomorphous lesions. This is a classical lesions over the palms. This is the classical lesions over the, axillary fold, posterior axillary fold. And whenever you see this type of presentation, you can just close your eyes and give the diagnosis that this is hand, foot and mouth disease. And whenever hand, foot and mouth disease occurs, on a background of eczema, that is called eczema coxsackium, because coxsackie virus, very important virus for hand, foot and mouth disease, apart from enterovirus 71. So eczema coxsackium you have seen. Now come to another case, interesting case. Let me see whether anybody has any questions. Now, this is not miliaria. Somebody has written eczematous miliaria, that looks different. So question somebody has asked, what is the, okay, Abhijit, your name was not visible. You gave the right answer, eczema coxsackium. Abhijit is our colleague in the department. Dr. Raghuveer is also here. So, what is the difference between eczema herpeticum and eczema coxsackium? Wait. Keep on waiting. So this is the story of a 10-year-old boy presented with eczematous skin lesions, high fever, fatigue. Skin lesions were present for 2 years. Fever and fatigue were of sudden onset just for 2 weeks. He was earlier diagnosed an established case of atopic dermatitis. However, this time the new lesions came. So let us look at the new lesions. See, so these are all old lesions. These are all old lesions. These are all old background lesions. These are new lesions. These are new lesions. These are new lesions. These are old lesions on the background eczema. These are new lesions. We had to admit this child in our ICH. Look at the conglomerations of the vesicles in a cluster-like fashion on a background erythema over the cubital fossae, cubital fossa rather. Though he had bilateral, that's why I said fossae, over the penis, shaft of the penis. Sorry. So this is, you have diagnosed, I'm sure by this time, you are asking about Kaposi's variceriform eruptions. Yes, Dr. Resham. Kaposi's variceriform eruptions or eczema herpeticum. Same, eczema herpeticum. And how do you treat eczema herpeticum? You admit the child. This is a medical emergency, please do remember. This is a medical emergency. The child needs to be admitted because there is significant morbidity as well as chances of mortality. So don't take chance with such a child. Immediately admit the child. There is medico-legal issue associated with it if you don't admit this child. Needs to be admitted because IV acyclovir is the treatment of choice. And you have to give acyclovir IV for 7 to 10 days. After there is significant fever subside within 2 to 3 days after starting IV acyclovir. The systemic symptoms, toxemic features all subside within 72 hours. And the skin lesions start subsiding from 5 to 7 days. So after 7 to 10 days, you switch over from IV acyclovir to oral acyclovir. But please do remember that suppose after 2 to 3 weeks, depending on the condition of the child, you discharge the child from the ward. But please, please, please do remember, continue it for 4 to 6 months because there is very high incidence of relapse in cases of herpes virus infections in an atopic child with frank eczema. So again, the child can land up with eczema herpeticum. If you don't continue for quite an adequate period of time, that means for 4 to 6 months. So this is after treatment in this child. See the nice clearance of the lesions from all the areas. He had cluster of vesicles over the pina, you have seen, over the hands, over the abdomen, over the penis. So any question regarding this? Or would you like to add anything? Somebody has already answered to the question. Somebody asked, dose of acyclovir, 10 milligram per kg per dose, thrice a day, IV infusion. Any other question? This is also called Kaposi's variceriform eruption. True. Does chickenpox vaccine prevent? No, it doesn't. This is herpes simplex virus. Chickenpox is varicella zoster virus. The two viruses are different. Test to confirm Kaposi's variceriform eruptions. Dr. Nirmala has asked, very simple bedside test is do a giant smear, see multinucleate check giant cells, and that is confirmatory. You do herpes simplex virus antibody, HSV antibody, IgG, IgM. IgG will be very high. IgM also will be very high. So next case is a 7-year-old girl who presented with weakness, hyperpigmented patches over the fingers and toes and lives for 1 year. So let us see. Look at it carefully, my friends. pigmentation over the toe, pigmentation over the lip, pigmentation over the tongue. And the child was very weak. When the child was admitted in the ward, looking at the peripheral blood smear, we got a clue. And we asked for some blood test level of a vitamin. So what clue we got and what vitamin level we asked for? Sudeep is answering as a rocket speed. I can see many, many of you have are answering. I can see Dr. Anupam Das, Dr. Sujata. Yes. So, yes. Bhavani Singh, Bornali Dutta. Yes, I can see. Shoviran Das. Yes, I can see the right answer. All of you have given the very right answer. That is, this is vitamin B12 deficiency induced pigmentation. Looking at the peripheral blast smear, you can diagnose megaloblast. Even if you are not a very efficient hematologist, just you are a resident, you can look at the hypersegmented neutrophils if you are able to see it. So that is the pointer towards vitamin B12 deficiency. And do a vitamin B12 level. That is what we did. And that was significantly low in this child. Now come to the next case. This is a 7-day-old newborn with skin lesions. Remember, it's 7-day-old. What is the diagnosis? This time I request my pediatrician colleagues to keep quiet. Let my dermatologist colleague to answer. What is the diagnosis? No, Bhavani, it is not omphalocele. No. LSCS induced stoma. No, Dr. Archana. This is a very specific condition. It is not erythema toxicum. I'll show you another picture. Do you see this? This is the defect, congenital defect. And what is the defect and what is the significance of it? Now it is open to the pediatrician colleagues also. Open to my pediatrician colleagues also. Except the ICH group. Because I think I have presented it and we have discussed it in the seminar. So OBGT, you are not allowed to open your mouth. Dr. Resham Basani, you are partially right. So you will get half marks for saying sternal cleft. What is the full answer? No, it is not diverticula. It is not divertication of the rectum. Yes, I can see somebody has given half answer. So, Resham and Dr. Sanjeev Agarwal's answer combined together is the correct answer. So, correct answer is, I have got two half of answer. So I combine these two. This is sternal cleft with supraumbilical raphe. Sternal cleft, you have seen. This is the sternal cleft and this is the supraumbilical raphe. When this defect is present, there is high incidence of aortic aneurysm. So looking at it, immediately you should refer the child to a pediatric cardiologist or pediatric cardiothoracic surgeon. So come to the next case. It is a neonate of 21 days who presents with bizarre pigmentation over face and limbs since birth. I'll ask my dermatologist colleagues to keep quiet. Please don't open your mouth now. Rather, here opening of the mouth is not important, I think, on this mode. Don't type on chat box. The question is open to the pediatrician colleague. What history will take? Any antenatal history is important. You can straight away come to the diagnosis also. Yes, some of you have answered rightly. This is neonatal chikungunya. Chikungunya fever from the mother, a neonatal age, presents with this type of pigmentation. This is called chick sign. Classical pigmentation of the nose, philtrum, upper lip joining the philtrum. This is called chick sign. And this is very characteristic of neonatal chikungunya, which is on the rise in India now. And it was first, one of the early cases of chikungunya in India was described from Kerala, actually, in your own journal, my pediatrician friends. I'm sure you know about this person, Professor Nair, very renowned pediatrician. So, chikungunya, you can see the findings shows the diffuse hyperpigmentation, especially over the face, nose, and also over the abdomen, extremities, and knuckles. So this was a case of neonatal chikungunya. Yes, anybody is saying anything? I think the time is up, but if you all want to continue, I can continue. For me, that is not a problem. What should we do? Apurvada? Or is it Apurvada? So everybody is writing, please continue, sir. Okay.
Continue, Kaur.
Okay. Thank you. So, let us come to the next case. This is the newborn, and you can see the skin lesions. Okay. Any diagnosis you would like to offer? Yes, I can see many of you have written very rightly. I'm happy that you have been able to diagnose a case of neonatal scabies. I'm sure because of these very characteristic lesions, but otherwise also looking at the tongue. What you should remember that in neonatal scabies, unlikely in adult scabies, you see vesicular lesions over the palms and soles. This is a very characteristic feature of neonatal scabies. This is because sarcoptic scabies, protein scabiein, is very strongly irritant for the skin of a neonate whose skin sensitivity has not developed over a period of time. So as a result of that, it acts as just like irritant contact dermatitis like thing. So that's why you see this type of vesiculations over the palms and soles. And you see only in neonatal scabies, vesiculation over the palms and soles. So this was the case of neonatal scabies. Now come to the next case. 21 day old baby presented with these asymptomatic lesions of 24 days duration, history of no history of fever or any other complaints. 21-day-old baby. Look at the lesions carefully. The other day we had a wonderful discussion on a topic. I'm sure Dr. Archana is smiling, looking at it. And she moderated the session so nicely. It was on, if I tell, you will get a lot of clues. So that's why I'm not telling. I'll tell after some time. But I'm sure Dr. Archana is smiling. Because she moderated the entire session, presented so nicely. Sudip. Dr. Sudip Ghosh. Don't start typing. Yes, I'm smiling, Dr. Archana. So, to my pediatrician colleague, what is the diagnosis? I'll tell you why did I say so. Any test you'd like to advise? Baby or mother or both, I think you will get some clue from it. Yes, somebody, Dr. Sukesh Gautam, I can see, has rightly pointed out. And you know, subsequently, others are also coming up with, yes, you are right. So whenever you see such lesions, the lesions are so characteristic that you should not confuse it with anything else. This type of, you know, slightly scaly, hemorrhagic patches present over the face and forehead around the eyes is classically called Racone sign. It very characteristic of neonatal lupus erythematosus with this type of lesions over the trunk. The other day, we had a wonderful discussion on connective tissue disease with a dermatologist in West Bengal. And it was very nicely moderated by a you know, great academician, Professor Archana Singhal from Delhi. And she is famous for her work on nail diseases, extensive work. And that's why I said Dr. Archana is smiling. And there also we discussed about neonatal ALE. So the test which you should do is ANF, anti-RO antibody. If baby and mother, anti-LA antibody in baby and mother, this is very, very important. And some of you have written that what other investigations, echo, yes, because congenital heart block is an important sequelae. And the commonest cause of congenital heart block is neonatal ALE because it is a rare condition. So final diagnosis is neonatal lupus erythematosus. Next case. It is a 6-month-old baby. History of chronic diarrhea, skin lesions for 1 month. Diagnosis. I'm sure that many of you have answered yes. You know, yeah, most of you have answered very rightly. It is classical history of diarrhea with this type of lesions present around the orifice, around the mouth, perioral, perianal, and over the extremities, basically eczematous lesions. Morphologically, they are eczematous lesions. Perianal, very classical, with a history of chronic diarrhea. And there is only one diagnosis, that is acrodermatitis enteropathica. Some of you have written zinc deficiency. Yes, it is zinc deficiency, but by and large in our setup, we do not see a pure zinc deficiency. We see in a background of multiple nutritional deficiency. So please, whenever you treat such children, you supplement with zinc, but look, you know, keep an eye on the other nutrition and deficiency features also, and give nutritional supplement also adequately. In our country, multiple nutrition and deficiency background is very, very common. Yes, anybody would like to ask any questions? Dose of zinc, 5 milligram per kg per day in 2 to 3 divided doses. 5 milligram per kg per day in 2 to 3 divided doses of elemental zinc. So this is the lesions over the extremities, acral distribution, periorificial distribution are the important features. Two important histories to diagnose the conditions. What are those? These are not only important for diagnosis, but also therapeutic response. So these questions are open to all. What are the two other important histories you would take, you would like to take? Yes, I can see some of you have answered. Irritability and photosensitivity. Yes, very rightly said so. Photosensitivity and irritability. And why it is important? Because when you start the child on zinc therapy, what is the first thing to go? It is the irritability of the child. The child which was very irritable at the beginning, if you start zinc therapy, within 48 hours the irritability goes. Photosensitivity goes within 72 hours, 3 days. Diarrhea starts reducing gradually from 3rd, 4th day or 5th day onwards. Skin lesions start subsiding after 2 weeks approximately. It takes longer period of time. So that's why it is important for prognostication of the disease as well as judging the therapeutic efficacy of zinc supplementation. Irritability and photophobia. These are two very important features of acrodermatitis enteropathica. So diagnosis was acrodermatitis enteropathica. So this is a quiz question. What is this condition is known as? In NICU, I have clipped this photo from ICH NICU. I have clicked it. So what is this condition known as? I can see, you know, full answer from one person. Others are giving half answer. And in fact, that is wrong answer. Just like half truth. You know, truth is very good, you know, but half truth is dangerous. It is much more dangerous than falsehood. So, in a lighter vein, I am saying, so full answer is somebody of you have written harlequin. Harlequin fetus is a dangerous, it's a different thing altogether. I saw only Dr. Agarwal has written harlequin color change. Now I can see Dr. Samipa Mukherjee and Dr. Samiran Das, Dr. Sakti. Many of you have written harlequin color change. See this midline, you know, clear distinction of color with erythema and bluish discoloration. This is called harlequin color change. This is a normal because of, this is called, you know, vaso-instability of the small capillaries of the skin of a newborn. And once that becomes stable, this color change subsides, right? So this is also a physiological skin change in the newborn. So you don't have to do anything apart from explaining it to the mother and counseling the mother. The mother may be very anxious about it. Particularly the mother of the first baby actually. This condition is known as harlequin color change. This next case is 5-year-old boy with high fever, failure to thrive, skin rash appears 3 days after starting phenobarbital for convulsion, had lesions over the trunk. I request my dermatologist colleagues to keep quiet, to restrain their fingers from typing. कोई क्वाइट नहीं होने से भी चलेगा पर हाथ मत चलाओ टाइम मत करो gutted psoriasis is Dr. Sanjeev Agarwal. I would say that you have a reasonably good knowledge. I don't know whether it is a pediatrician or dermatologist. Dermatologist होने से कोई क्रेडिट नहीं मिलेगा. पेडियाटिशियन होने से गटेड सोरियासिस लिखने से मैं क्रेडिट पूरा दूंगा. But from dermatologist, it is very much expected that dermatologist should be able to say that this is gutted psoriasis. Very good. But what is odd about gutted psoriasis here? What is odd about gutted psoriasis here? Now it is open to dermatologist colleagues also. What is odd about this is not pleva samipa. Keratoderma blenorrhagica occurs over palms and soles. This is not keratoderma, Dr. Jaydeep Das. This there is odd about gutted psoriasis is basically see, gutted psoriasis is a dry lesion. Psoriasis lesions are dry lesions. Here these are moist lesions. The evidence is that if you try to remove it, you will see the moist surface, right? So these are stuck on appearance, moist surface, and you see there is a slight dimpling at the center of some of the lesions. So this is called limpet like lesion. Classically these have been described as limpet like lesions, and my dermatologist colleagues, I know the moment I tell you the limpet like lesions, you will immediately you will google and find out. So what is the limpet like lesions? Come to the more story about it. The story is longer. The child also had lesions over the glans penis and swelling of the left knee joint. This is a lesion of the glans penis, and this is the swelling of the knee, left knee. So do you think of some possibilities now? No, this is not syphilis. Samipa, this is not syphilis. Somo, this is not. Resham has given the right answer, and subsequently, many others have also started with the right answers. Yes, you see a limpet-like lesions, skin lesions which look like psoriasis. You see a succinate balanitis, what I showed you on the penis, is a succinate balanitis as well as pubescitis. Both can occur together. This is pubescitis and balanitis on the glans. Though this is not very classical balanitis here, but this is pubescitis and joint swelling. So all these three things make together a disease which is known as, you see, the joint swelling. The joints are, knee joints are asymmetrical, and this is grossly swollen, you can make out. So this is a case of Ritter's disease. To more to that, you see the classical psoriasis lesions over the scalp also. And a very characteristic, a very important feature of Ritter's disease is the high ESR. There are only a couple of conditions. Whatever little bit medicines I know, from dermatologic point of view, I have already tried to remember that in Ritter's disease, ESR is almost always nearly 100. It is 90, apart from multiple myeloma, where ESR is very high. I'm sure my pediatrician colleagues must be, smiling at me with my very limited knowledge, but I have remembered that I have to remember dermatologic condition in which the ESR is very high, and that is Ritter's disease, where ESR is always high. This is one thing which I was looking for when the child was admitted in the ICH ward. I kept on asking the resident, so what is the ESR? What is the ESR? And the moment report came, he said, sir, the ESR is 90, because I told him, ESR should be around 80-90, and then only the diagnosis of Ritter's disease will be provisionally established. And this skin biopsy was suggestive of pustular psoriasis. That is another feature of Ritter's disease. It more or less looks like pustular psoriasis. And subsequently, HLA-B27 was positive. So this was a case of childhood Ritter's disease. Please remember this constellation of features. We'll go to the next case. the dermatologist colleagues, please don't open your mouth. This is for, or start typing. This is for pediatrician friends. So I'm sure that you can make out the diagnosis, my friends. What is this? Yes, herpes, ophthalmic herpes zoster. That is the right answer from Dr. Moshumi Mukherjee. Dr. Tamili answered herpes, but you have to specify that this is herpes zoster, not herpes simplex. Close up of the herpes zoster. Herpes zoster is fairly uncommon in children. Ophthalmic herpes zoster, whenever you see, you have to look at the involvement of the tip of the nose, which the child has got here. And this is called Hutchinson's sign. If it is present, ipsilateral corneal ulceration is a possibility. Immediately, you have to ask the parents to take the child to an ophthalmologist to rule out the corneal ulceration, because that can be serious consequence of it. So this was the case of herpes zoster ophthalmicus. But what I wanted to discuss with you tonight is that many a times you will see such a child or such a young girl of 10 year old having these lesions and diagnosed as herpes, and acyclovir has already been given. I'm sure my dermatologist colleagues can make out what it is, but for my pediatrician, yes, I can already see. I think Galaxy A70 is Abhijit, isn't it, Abhijit? So, yes, Dr. Subhik Ghosh has answered. This is insect bite or beetle dermatitis. This insect bite is the bizarre pattern of presentation, very bizarre pattern of presentation. And you don't see any vesicles. You see small, small papules. And it occupies exactly the same. This is one of the mimickers in dermatology. You see? So, and this, please do remember, in herpes, there will be throbbing sensation. But in insect bite, there will be burning sensation, cutting sensation. You can ask one simple question to the child, that do you feel that as if some acid has been poured on your skin? Acid has poured acid on your skin. That type of burning occurs. It is a very bad type of burning experience. So that is the, very characteristic history the child will come out with. And here the child will need oral steroid, prednisolone, for 5 to 7 days. That only bring back the quality of life. And it is multi-segmental and bizarre. It doesn't follow any segment or any dermatome. But somehow it is restricted over here because the insect has got crossed with the eyelid and the eyebrow. So that's why this secretion has crawled, and you can see all this, happening on the skin, all this insult on the skin. So this was an insect bite, hypersensitivity mimicking herpes. So next case is a 3-year-old girl with history of fever for 6 months, hyperpigmentation, ulceration on the elbow for 1 month. Dr. Archana, are you still there? Yes, I can see, yes, Dr. Archana, thank you. This is one thing which we discussed the other day with Dr. Archana, and the child had fever, this pigmentation, edema of the face. So what is the diagnosis from my pediatrician colleagues? You have already got some clue. The moment I said I have, we had a discussion with Dr. Archana, because I told you the last time, what did you discuss? Yes, many of you have answered. I can see Dr. Samipa, Dr. Bhavani, Dr. Barnali, Dr. Sujata, Dr. Mausumi Mukherjee. This is the childhood. I shall come to it after showing few more slides about the child. This is a case of childhood dermatomyositis, right? And the child had proximal muscle weakness, and subsequently all the investigations, muscle enzymes and everything came very high. But what is the point of interest here? Point of interest is, in childhood dermatomyositis, please do remember the two most important features are, number one is extensive calcinosis cutis, and number two, extensive vasculitis. These are the two important features of childhood dermatomyositis.
As compared,
pardon?
Sound?
Suna yachana? Suna yachana? Childhood dermatomyositis, too important. Am I audible? Am I audible?
Yes, ha ha, suna yachche, bolun.
Okay.
Kotha shunte pachche na kichu.
Mayani bolchen shunte pachchen na?
আমরা তো আমি তো শুনতে পাচ্ছি।
আচ্ছা আমি এটা লাগাচ্ছি, হেডফোনটা লাগাচ্ছি, দেখি মায়া যদি বেটার শুনতে পান। এতে
ঠিক
মায়া দি শুনতে পাচ্ছেন? এবারে মায়া দি ভাই শুনতে পাচ্ছেন? Am I audible? Is it better than before or worse than before?
Same.
Then, okay, then I am continuing. So the two most important features of childhood dermatomyositis, one is extensive vasculitis, second is calcinosis. So here you see, there is evidence of both here. This is the interesting slide for that, actually, just to give you an idea. Because of vasculitis, there is an ulcer. And what you see as a white material coming out of that ulcer is nothing but calcinosis. This is the calcium. In a word, you can say this is bone which is coming out of it. Bone doesn't mean it is coming from the humerus or coming from the elbow joint. This is the elbow joint, actually. This is the calcinosis of the skin which is popping out of the ulcerated area. So both the features of childhood dermatomyositis have been picked up in this particular slide. And this is the calcinosis of the muscle calcification in the same child. So this was a case of childhood dermatomyositis. This is what I told you, two important features of childhood dermatomyositis is calcinosis and widespread vasculitis. So let us go to the next slide. Oh, I think we have come to the end. Any other questions you have related to? Anything you would like to know related to today's discussion?
Sandipan.
Yeah.
It's almost 20 years back that we have seen this case in medical college.
Yes.
You remember this?
Yes.
And
absolutely.
When you went there to see this case.
Absolutely.
That was it.
Absolutely. You immediately got it, Apurva. Yes, absolutely. Professor Apurva Ghosh and I had gone to medical college to see this particular case. This child was admitted in our Calcutta Medical College, and the pediatrician, being a good friend of Apurva, invited him. And Apurva took me along. Professor Apurva Ghosh took me along with him. So we saw this case. Do you remember? Yes, I remember, Apurva. I definitely remember. The child was in very bad shape and without any diagnosis that time. And we saw this child We made the diagnosis, we asked for the investigations, because this child was going on for several months with fever of unknown origin, FEO or PEO, pyrexia of unknown origin.
The other advantage of MRI are, there are no radiation hazard, it rules out the mimics, but the limitation being not available.
And many cases of childhood SLE, I must say, whatever we see at Institute of Child Health, that you see, many such children have very faint rash over the cheek, malaria, or some lesions inside the concha of the ear, or in the retroauricular fold area. But the child is having fever for 6 months, receiving at least 10 to 12 courses of antibiotic. So I always say, whenever a child comes with fever of unknown origin, please keep in mind an etiology of collagen vascular disease. Please do keep in mind the etiology of collagen vascular disease. Try to look at the face and inside the concha carefully for the presence of any rash. That is very important. So any other question from anybody?
It is available.
Can you show the sponsor slide?
Yes.
Can you show
Definitely.
People are living. Can you display the sponsor slide?
Yes. Sincere thanks to Dr. Reddy's lab. Mr. Devabroto and his team. Devabroto is the RBM. Grand Era Division of Dr. Reddy's lab for supporting this academic event. I think it is past 10 now. Okay, we are supposed to stop it at 9:30. So it has overshoot half an hour. And till the end, all the people who joined at the beginning till the end, they were there. So that is something which is satisfying experience for me.
Sandipan, excellent presentation. Excellent.
Thank you. Thank you.
Had in confirmed AIS on MRI. So that is
anything you'd like to say, Apurvada? So thank you very much. Thank you, everybody. Bye. Good night. See you sometime.